do these Irish get these ideas from? I just don't know. But I'm glad that they do. That story was collected by Thomas Croker, was his name, and he went about Ireland collecting stories, and that was one that he collected. And this next story is a story that I learned in the first storytelling class I took, which I took under duress. I didn't want to take a storytelling class. I was at Leslie College at the time, and I wanted to take a theater class, because when I was in high school and had been in college before, I was so shy. I was so painfully shy. I couldn't... Wow. Incredibly painfully shy. I just couldn't... I got over it. There I was in my 30s, and I was going to get a degree, and I thought, gee, I should take a theater class now that I'm not shy. But it was closed, and I said, oh, what is this? And they said, well, no, take storytelling. And I said, no, look, this is the last time I'm going to school, and I'm not taking any more courses, and I want a theater course, and blah, blah. She said, no, take storytelling, you'll like it. Oh, what is it? I don't even know, what is it, storytelling? So I went to take a storytelling class, and there was Jennifer Justice at Leslie College teaching, and she told this story in the first class as an example of what storytelling was, and I was, it's like, boom, a lightning bolt. That was it for me, and storytelling ever since. So this is the story of Molly O'Donohue, and this is dedicated to Jennifer Justice, who taught it to me. Now, Molly O'Donohue was a very clever girl, but her cleverness was not in her words. No, because Molly O'Donohue was a stomach-churning, knee-knocking, palm-sweating, stuttering, shy person. She couldn't say boo to a goose, though I don't know what would happen if you did, and I don't know why you would want to, but she couldn't say anything to anybody except her old ma. That was it. She lived with her old ma way up in the Wicklow Mountains, and once a year she would go down into Dublin City, because I did say she was clever, did I not? Her cleverness was in her hands. She could carve the most amazing toys. And she would go once a year to sell these toys down in Dublin City, and it was such a long walk down from her house that she would have to stay with her cousins overnight. Now, what's the problem with that? Dinner and a sleepover, I mean, what's the big deal? Well, I'll tell you what. When I was in Ireland, it was still the tradition that after dinner, everybody either plays their harp or their flute or their whistle, or they sing a song, or they tell a joke or a story, or they do some dance, but not our Molly. Every time she had dinner with her cousins, at the end of the dinner, she would say, I feel sick, and then she'd run and hide upstairs under the bolster to the next morning. But this time I want to tell you about her ma packed her a wonderful lunch, a huge bannock of bread, a big slab of cheese, 6 of her favorite cookies, and a big jug of milk, and she packed that all into one bag and all of her toys in the other, and she threw them over her shoulders, and she went striding out into a beautiful sunshiny day, such as you rarely see in Ireland. And she walked such a long way in such a short time, she thought, maybe I can just sit down and eat my lunch. Normally she would walk and eat at the same time. So she ate the whole thing at once, which made her very sleepy. So she decided she would take a little nap. So she took a little nap on the side of the road. She thought it was a little nap, but when she woke up, why, the rain was falling into her face and her eyes, and when she popped her eyes open, she could see that the sun was going down behind those Wicklow Mountains, and soon it would be dark. So she started walking and walking and walking, and soon it started to rain. But not any little bit of rain, no. The wind began to howl, and there was a huge crack of lightning through the sky, and boom, big booms of thunder. Oh, my God, it was so awful, and another crack of lightning. And she could see in that last creak of lightning, oh, look. She could see that there was a little house on the side of the road, but she had never seen it before. And she thought to herself, well, with the wind and rain to the back of me and a warm house to the front of me, I'm just going to go and knock on the door. So she did. The door creaked open. And now if it was dark and desperate on the outside, it was warm, dry, and light and inviting on the inside. And there, sitting on a chair with like a dollop of whipped cream done on the top of her head, was an old woman. And she had more wrinkles than the cat has fleas and bright, shining blue eyes. And she looked right at Molly O'Donohue and she said, well, now, Molly O'Donohue, come on in out of that rain and warm yourself by the fire. Well, Molly had never seen this woman before, nor the house, but with the wind and rain to the back of her and a warm fire to the front of her, she went right in and closed the door behind her. Hung up her things and she warmed herself front and back. And when she was completely warm and dry, the old woman said, now, Molly O'Donohue, How about some dinner? And she clapped her hands twice. And out from another room floated a table. And on that table was every good thing to eat. Well, the two of them sat there. And they ate and ate till they could eat no more. And they didn't say a word, which suited Molly just fine. And when they were finished, the old woman clapped her hands twice. And the table floated off. And then she sat back in her chair and she said, well, now, Molly O'Donoghue, after a good dinner, it's a little bit of entertainment that I'm wanting. You don't happen to have a fiddle or a flute in your bags over there, do you? And Molly said, no. Oh, fine, said the woman. How about singing me a songy for the singing? No, said the woman, said Molly. Oh, fine, said the woman. Well, then, let's see, I know. How about a story? Everybody has a story. No, said the woman, said Molly. And the woman said, well, now, Molly O'Donoghue, excuse me, are my old ears hearing you right? Do you mean to tell me that you're not even going to give me a story after all the hospitality I've shown you? And Molly said, yes, I mean, no, I mean, you don't. I can't. I won't. And the old woman said, fine, then, Molly O'Donoghue, out with you. And the door opened, and Molly was pushed out into the dark of the night. Her two bags and her cloak followed, and phew, the door shut behind her. Oh, she says, as she picks up her things and starts walking down that road, thinking, well, at least it stopped raining. I mean, oh, I'm near destroyed with the fear of this, walking down this road by myself. Oh. And she hears behind her, way away, she hears the sound of a pony. And she's thinking, oh, now think of that. That must be a pony cart. Maybe some of the farmers going into the market. Maybe I could get a ride with them. Because you don't really know who's out on a night like tonight. On the other hand, I don't really know who's on that cart, do I? So she decides to jump off the road and hide behind some bushes. And she's hiding behind the bushes as the cart gets closer and closer and closer. And then stops right in front of where she's hiding. And she pushes the bushes aside. And she looks, and on that cart are two strange men. One is really tall and skinny and has a long pointy nose and a pointy, pointy chin and a big Adam's apple. And the other one is very short and he is as round as he is tall. And he has no hair on his head except for his bushy eyebrows and the hair growing out of his ears and his nose. And he has a very strange voice besides. So he turns to the tall fella and he says, who will help us with our burden? And the big tall fella says, I will, Ralph. And then probably you. So that would be the three. Two of us. Molly O'Donoghue, that's who. She's hiding right there in the bushes. And don't the two of them jump right down and they pick her up and they drag her around to the back of the cart. There on that cart is a huge box and it's covered with padlocks and chains and straps of leather. And they make Molly carry it far, far from the dark road into the darker fields where the big tall fella takes out a shovel and the short one says, dig us a hole, Molly O'Donoghue, as deep as you are tall and as wide as you are long, as you value your life. So she starts digging, doesn't she? And she's digging. Choo, choo, choo. She's digging and digging until she's throwing the dirt up over her head. And when she's finally done, she climbs out of that hole. And the short fella puts his hand right on her shoulder and says, well, job well done there, Molly. And now, who knows where we're burying our treasure? And the tall fella says, oh, I do. And you do, Ralph. And Molly O'Donoghue, that's who, says the short fella. And who should we bury with our treasure? Well, Molly doesn't wait for the answer to that, no. She goes running, running, running as fast as she can. She goes running, running, running from that field back to the road. The little short fella comes after her. He's on his little short legs saying, I'll catch you, you scamp. But the tall fella, he falls into the hole. And the short fella saying, I'll catch you, you'll never escape me. And she goes running, running, running. She goes running down that road. And then she sees a square light in the distance. Oh, maybe it's the woman. Maybe she's still up. And indeed, it is the cottage. And she knocks on the door. The door cranks open and she jumps in and boom, shuts the door behind her. For there's the woman sitting right where she left her. And she says, well, now, Molly O'Donoghue, where have you been and what have you been doing? And Molly says, where have I been and what have I been doing? Oh, wasn't I on the dark road to Dublin all by myself? And wasn't I near scared to death of it? Well, I was. And didn't I think to hide when I heard some fellas coming? Well, I did. But was it good enough? No, it wasn't, because didn't they find me? And she tells her the whole story. And when she's finished, the old woman says, well, now, Molly O'Donoghue, that was a fine story. It was. It was. And it ought to be a lesson to you as well. For your own story is a good enough story to tell. For if you have the courage to live it, you have to have the courage to tell it. And after a fine story, she says, I'm for bed. And she clapped her hands twice. All the lights went out, and Molly felt herself drifting off to sleep as easy as a leaf falls off a tree. Now, the next morning, Molly woke up. She stretched and she yawned and, oh, what a crick she had in her neck. Oh, my, and what a pain in her back. Was she in a bed? No. Was she in a cottage? No. She was on the side of the road. Oh, says Molly, and she stood up and looked this way and that. Why, she couldn't even see a cottage. Oh, she says, now that was some weird dream. That's what that was. That was just about the weirdest dream I think I have ever had. And she picked up her cloak, which had been her bed, and she picked up her bag of toys, and she picked up her food bag, which was heavy. Did I not say she ate her entire lunch? She looked inside, and there were baked potatoes and biscuits from the night before. Oh, she says, now that's weird. That is some weird stuff. That's what that is. That is very, very strange. And she threw that bag over her shoulder, and she went in to Dublin City, where she sold all of her toys, and she went and had dinner with her cousins. But did she run and hide after dinner? Indeed not. She told this story to them, and they told it to my cousins, and I just told it to you. It's the story of Molly O'Donoghue. Thank you. And so ends the first set, but to end this set, I would ask to have Susan would like to play just one song for you all, okay? Yep, and then we'll have a 10-minute break, okay? So let's, Susan, what are you going to be playing? Okay, but what are you going to be playing?
I'm playing The Parting Glass.
The Parting Glass, there you go.
There's a story to it, I'm sure, no? There's many people who know how to sing.